Whoa. Big lorry coming. And he's off. Oh. Good morning, good morning, good morning. And happy Easter to you. Or Passover or whatever you celebrate. Derek Watson here, the angry dentist. Back after my Easter break. You can't really have a break, can you? As a dentist, you can't have a break. You can't. Not if you're the boss, not if you're the principal. You don't. People think the staff do, and they think you do, but you don't. I mean, I'm just I'm not single-handed. I've got a part-time implantologist. The old owner, you know, used to own the place, comes back and still does implants. And my wife's a hygienist who works there part-time. But we shut the practice for a week, just literally closed it. But then the phone keeps ringing. People don't, you know, you can send out a thing saying that, that the surgery's shut, but most people won't. You know, a couple of stick it on the fridge, but most won't. So phone keeps ringing and, hello, you know, can I change my appointment? Yeah, I suppose so. What are you going to say? No? I mean, you know, what, if you just say, no, I'm sorry, you know, but you probably didn't get the memo, we're actually shut this week. You know, this is the emergency line you've come through on, because the emergency line is literally switched through to my mobile. It's a luxury that you can afford as a private practitioner, because, you know, your private practitioners are going to be unfailingly polite and apologetic if they realise they're talking to you, rather than drunkenly insist that you reopen the surgery at 10:30 because they've just got in from work. So I've got a link from my home where it's not a bad day actually. It's rained overnight. Well, it's a sort of scattered cumulus, as you aviators would call it. Yeah, so I sort of can dial into the work computer from home, which is quite good. Use a software product called TeamViewer, which they do a free version for non-commercial use. And if you set it up on both computers, you can control the work computer from home as though you're sort of sitting at work. And it's great for doing things like, just people who want to book appointments. I mean, it's money, isn't it? At the end of the day, it's all money. If someone rings up and says, look, I've decided to have those couple of crowns done, you're not going to say, oh, yeah, why don't you, ring in first thing Tuesday morning when the reception's going to be there? Because you're not going to do that, not if you're sensible. You'll say, yeah, no problem. When do you want to come in, you know? Give me a day and I'll book you in. And then it's in the bank, isn't it? It's booked. Once it's booked, it's as good as in the bank. So, well, we didn't have too many, had a few, and then had a bit of a problem with our phone system for a while, whereby we're in a place called the Marlow Innovation Centre, and it's the least innovative innovation centre you'd ever come across. It was set up next to one of the worst schools with one of the worst history in the country. And typical public sector largesse dictates that the worse something's performing, the larger budget it should have. So, you know, the inverse of the private sector. So they threw money at this place, built a school the size of St Paul's Cathedral, and because they figured none of these kids are going to go to university, they thought they might as well put a unit up right next to it with state-of-the-art internet and hot desk in, you know, where you can just like rent anything from a desk to a unit to an entire floor, in the hope that one or two of these kids might be the next Bill Gates and not really be benefiting from formal education, but might be sort of an idiot savant and go into this innovation centre and start sawing it off with something to do with the internet. The web, the World Wide Web, that's where they're, you know, everyone makes them big money. But of course, it hasn't worked out like that. It's full of fat, middle-aged, white dentists like me, who just look at it and thought, oh, that's a cheap commercial space. And it's cheap because obviously the kids are not going to rent it. Just what 16-year-old? What 15-year-old who's not going to take any GCSEs is going to rent two units in an innovation centre? But that's not my point. My point is, in America, it was an innovation centre, it would be innovative, wouldn't it? You think, oh, if we were in like Silicon Valley or somewhere, in an innovation centre, it'll be an incubator, wouldn't it? It'll be full of people coming up with Bitcoin apps and all sorts of podcasting, multimedia, whatever, ideas and things. But not in the UK, oh no. It's literally, it's like being locked in your bedroom at home. It's like, literally, you're treated like you're 12. What they do is they come in, they say, come in, we've got everything you need, we've got fire extinguishers, we've got heart LED, pump things to electrify your heart, get them going again, defibs. We do all the health and safety, we give you tea and coffee, we've got a kettle, we've got a phone, we've got internet, high-speed internet, it's all here, it's like a feast of stuff, just all you need to do is come in, start making money, just come in with your brainwave. And then you come in and then you find out that, it's basically, they've got fast web browsing and that's it. If you want to do anything at all, other than web browsing, you can't, because it's their internet. So, if you want to do FTP, SSH in, if you want to run a website from your NAS or anything, all right, you can't do it. Because they say, no, can I have access to my control panel? No. Can I have access to my subnet? No. Just come and talk to us. We'll tell you if you can. Oh, no, you can't. No, you can't do that. And the phone system's the same. I had a problem with the phone system. We had patients ringing in, and the phone number that came up on my mobile was the actual phone number of the centre. So it looked like the centre was ringing me all the time. So I'm thinking, I know that's a patient, but I don't know which patient. So if I couldn't get to the phone in time and it was like a missed call or something, hang on, junction of death. If it was a missed call or something, then I couldn't get back to them. Or more annoyingly, what would happen was someone would ring me up about 10 o'clock at night. And what they would do is they would ring the number because they're, to a large extent, they're sort of brought up on the National Health Service way of doing things. And so they ring the number expecting an answer phone, just saying, when you open in the morning. And then they get me to pick up the phone. So the dentist picks up the phone. Hello, can I help? Have you got a problem? No. So they hang up. And okay, so they're embarrassed. They're embarrassed. They didn't want to talk to someone. They just wanted a nice little NHS answer phone, a useless answer phone, that just told them when the service would cease to become useless next morning when someone deigned to go to the office and sit at a desk. And they didn't get that. So it takes them a bit by surprise. And so what they do is they hang up. And of course, you can't find out who they are because you've got no phone number. You've just got the centre's phone number. So one of these, I went in over the weekend because I had to upgrade the IT. I needed to put in a wired network because the phone system that they put in was, they're like, oh no, we're spending £8,000 on this. Actually, you're not. I'm spending £8,000. Me and the rest of the tenants are spending £8,000 on this. No consultation, notice or no, I don't think anyone even requested this. Just someone came along and said to them, look, we do the maintenance on your phones and we've got to tell you they're a bit out of date. We've got a much better system now, which will only cost you £8,000, but it's going to be all singing, all dancing. So what they do is they come in, they take out all the old phones, they put in a load of new phones that probably cost about £5 each, with all these programmable keys on that do sod all. Nothing. Still, all this system will do is make outgoing phone calls and receive incoming phone calls, same as the old one. It's supposed to have an online seat panel type interface that does NAFL and most, you know, is offline half the time, and most of the things that they promised it would do, like, it hasn't even got basic functionality. Even the sort of stuff that you could get from Skype or Vonage, it doesn't have that. And we've paid for it, this bleeding edge, bleeding phone system. So now I'm going off the grid. I've put a router in internally. I'm going to hardwire my network internally. I'm not going to put up with not knowing who's logged onto my system. You know, I've got CQC involved here. I've got privacy and security issues. I don't want all my patient data to be open to any bloody spotty oik who decides that he wants to do a bit of packet sniffing on my Wi-Fi. So, you know, you don't. This is the trouble, though, as a dentist, right? You have to be anything. People say, oh, hello, you know, can I talk to... And the answer is always yes, isn't it, on the phone. Can I talk to the manager? Yes. You're talking to him. Can I talk to the owner? Yes. Can I talk to the principal? Yes. Can I talk to the IT? Who's in head of IT? Yes. Can I talk to your chief financial officer? Yes. You're speaking to him. He's here. It's me, all right? So... I had to go in and so I'm on my knees right on the Saturday before Easter Sunday at the surgery, moving shelves around, unpacking shelves, moving shelves around to get wires stapled to skirting boards to get this wired network in. But it's going to speed it up and it's going to improve reliability, etc., etc. So it's going to be worth it. So, and I've told the staff to get in a bit early to clear up. So hopefully everything should be clear by the time I get here. No, I'm going to go and help them. So, and one of the, one of the phone calls we got was, can I make an appointment? I'd like to make an appointment. I think my teeth are going a bit decayed. No clue as to why they think that, but no, I just think my teeth are going a bit decayed. Okay, obviously a young girl. Okay, what's the, you know... When would you like to come in? Are you a patient here? Yeah, I am a patient here. Look in the records. No, can't find her. Okay, what was your last dentist? Oh, I don't know. Anyway, it turns out she'd been in care. And she obviously had, hadn't taken much care of her. Let's put it that way, judging by what she was telling me about her teeth. I understand... I personally think children in care should be taken more care of than children with parents, because they are vulnerable, and they are what the state that many of them end up in, I think, is unforgivable. With respect to all the carers out there who do a brilliant job with the children that they're brought, shame on the rest of you. That's all I can say. But anyway, this girl, because they're just chucked out with no life, they have no life skills, you know? They're just chucked out into the world with no skills to cope with, to do even things like talk about or make a dental appointment or anything. So anyway, it turned out that she'd rung the wrong dentist and she thought she was ringing another dentist. And she'd rung around and got through, and we were just the only dentist who was around to pick up the phone, and as usual, and she probably was better off diverted back to the practice that she'd been last seen at. But again, it's, you know, my thought for the day is what I'm going to do. I tell you what, I was going to do nurse indemnity today, because there's a big thing about nurse indemnity and the Scott review and everything, and whether or not dental nurses require indemnity. GDC says they do, or does it really, or, you know, etc. But I'm going to do all that tomorrow, because my sort of shower thought this morning was, in between, I mean, I tell you what, I've got a mole in my lawn. I don't even think it's a mole. I think it's a badger or a bear or something big, because the size of these mole holes, I mean, normally you have little mole hills, like they're about like a few centimetres tall. this thing is building ramparts, fortified earthwork ramparts. These things are big. And when I try and dig down and find out the hole, this mole is clever. He's a really formidable mole. I have moles in my lawn every year, okay? And, you know, I've got about 8 mole traps. And so every year I deploy 3 or 4 or 5 of these mole traps, catch the mole, and the mole will stop. That's it for the rest of the year. No more mole. This year, I think I have met my match. I have met the mole from hell. I mean, literally, he burrows down as far as hell. I have tried to dig down these mole holes, and they are deep. Normally a mole, you know, would be, you put your hand down a mole hill to the depth of your wrist, and you can usually feel where the hole is, where he's gone. Not this guy. Oh no. He's evolved. Evolution has taken place in my garden. All the moles that are easy to catch, I've caught. I am now up to second generation moley, where he's running along subterranean at a depth of about a foot, I'd say, 18 inches. That's about 30 to 45 centimeters for you, those you young'uns. And it's very difficult to set mole traps at that, because they're not, you can't even see them. Once you've set them, they're subterranean. They're down. I might as well dig a hole and sit down there and just wait for him with a shotgun. And he's smart. He's backfilling these holes, right? I didn't think I had a lot of pebbles in my lawn, but having sort of dug around, having dug around in it for the last few weeks, I have decided that not only have I got a lot of moles, a lot of worms, and a lot of stones as well. Because what he's doing is what most people don't realise. If you remember one thing about this podcast, now just remember this. A molehill is not on a through route. They don't put molehills on through routes. What they do is they want to establish a through route. So what happens is, let's say a mole is going to build the M1, right? And what he wants to do is, when he's clearing out all the earth from that hole, he wants to chuck it off to the side somewhere. So he digs a side tunnel, and then he goes up and he starts throwing it out the side, right? Like the Great Escape, where they had the tunnels and they had to decide where to get rid of the earth. And you don't get rid of the earth in the tunnel, do you? You dig a side tunnel and then you take it up to the surface and you stick it in your trouser pockets and you walk around and you scuff it into the, you know, except I wouldn't mind if he was scuffing it around, but he's not. He's just leaving it in bloody great piles. So anyway, if you put a mole trap in a mole run under a mole hill, you won't catch him, because that's not, he's not running that way. He's cleared that tunnel out. He's quite happy with that tunnel. He doesn't need to go and have a quick look at the old slag pile anymore, does he? He's just, you know, he's not going to go that way. So what you have to do is you have to follow the tunnel back to the T-junction where it intersects with the main tunnel. Years worth of moley knowledge I'm giving you here. Free of charge. So a mole that's tunneling at about 18 inches below the surface and backfilling these waste tunnels with earth and stones is a formidable foe, I tell you. Someone worthy of the hunt. This mole is going on my wall. When I catch this mole, there's going to be somewhere in my garden shed, there's going to be a teeny, teeny, weeny little picture frame. And in that picture frame is going to be the moley's head, because that's where he's going. And he will go there. But I've had 8 mole traps down for about a week. 10 days. 8. That's my entire stock. I've got to the point, I am so desperate, that when he digs a new molehill, I've had to decide which mole trap to pull up. To put down, and I won't buy any more. They're £5 each, these bloody things, and they take a week or two to arrive. So, and it's like choosing one of your children to kill. You know, you've got to think, oh, which one? And you know, and you're thinking to yourself, I know what's going to happen. The first time I pull a bloody trap up, that's going to be where he's going to go, isn't it? So, and 8 traps is unheard of. It's an unprecedented number of traps. I mean, you can't just have 12 mole traps on hand just in case, you know, you get mega mole, but which is what I've got. And you can't rent them or anything. You can't borrow them. I don't know anyone who's got any of them. Everyone who's got some is using them all. And I'm not going to get a mole catcher. I am not going to get a mole catcher. I'm not going to pay some toothless bloke 60 quid to come along and show me how to catch a mole. I know how to catch a mole. But I don't know how to catch a mole, obviously. So, but I'm going to get him. I'm going to get him. Anyway, what was I saying? Oh, yeah. So, my shower thought was that the NHS and the dental system in general is working so badly, right? So badly. And it's these phone calls that are making me come to this conclusion. Excuse me. That there must be a ton of pent-up demand. It just suddenly occurred to me. I mean, in 1948, when the dental health service was invented, there was a pent-up demand because basically there were only private dentists and a lot of people just making do with not much dentistry. And it just occurred to me that we've got a very similar situation at the moment. The NHS is, even the patients who are being taken on, they're having as little as possible done. So there's a ton of untreated disease, really, even in the cohort that's attending regularly. And then you've got the cohort that, you know, isn't attending regularly and probably doesn't attend regularly anyway. And then, you know, they probably not much need or demand from that group. But then you've got a third group of people who are literally ringing people, you know, practices like mine, saying, you know, I've been to see my dentist and he's told me that he will see me on the NHS, providing I get all my treatment done before I try and register. So many people are being excluded from the current system. But as and when a solution is found, you know, when the floodgates open, or will they? I mean, I don't know whether they ever will again. I don't know, certainly the system at the moment is conducive and is literally designed to keep people out of the system, isn't it? I mean, who in their right mind, there's not going to be another 1948, we're not going to have another NHS style rush for the doors as people, you know, get a system that they can suddenly afford and come into. So how's it going to be solved? I mean, perhaps that pressure is always going to be there now, you know, that these people that were forced out of the system slowly by the 2006 contract, and which now are now, you know, the pressure's built up now. It's 10 years later now, and you're getting, you know, almost everybody's had less dentistry than they've really needed since then. So, you know, the pent-up pressure just to have oral health, I think, is massive. It's just occurred to me that I'm standing behind the dam here that could break, or at least it's going to flood. You know, it's going to flood over the top. So, anyway, that's my thought for the day. So, I don't have many been in this job a long time, so I haven't really overbooked this morning because I think we may have emergencies. So, anyway, I'm going to go in and see, help with the tidy up effort, and hope you had a nice Easter. I certainly did. Need to lose some weight. I'll talk to you tomorrow. Okay, bye.